Hello everyone, Narcissist Free almost here, and today I wanted to talk about narcissistic abuse and forgiveness. Wow, I know this is a big one and something I've given a lot of thought about over many years. First though, we have to talk about betrayal and the fact that the narcissist does betrayal like none other. They betray our confidence, they betray our trust, they get your friends and co-workers to betray you and even your own family. That's something most people who haven't been in a narcissistically abusive relationship get. The hardest part of recovery from a narcissist is coping with and processing the devastation done to your psychology and probably every aspect of your entire life that, of course, stems from all their betrayals. Now, according to betrayal trauma theory, only fairly recently proposed in 1991 by Jennifer Freud, PhD, a person may experience trauma when they are terrified, sometimes for their physical safety or their life. They are betrayed by someone who they depend on for survival, such as a parent or a caregiver on whom they rely for food, shelter, and other basic needs. Experiences like physical, sexual, or sadistic abuse in childhood by a caregiver are examples of traumatic betrayals. The betrayal can cause children to develop post-traumatic stress disorder, particularly if the incident caused a lot of fear. Furthermore, betrayal trauma is usually experienced in relationships with intimate partners, especially if a person has experienced trauma in the past. However, people may also experience betrayal trauma at the hands of others, such as close friends, colleagues, or other people in their life. People also experience institutional betrayal, which occurs when an institution that someone relies upon fails to prevent or appropriately respond to wrongdoings by individuals within the context of the institution, for example, in cases of sexual assault at a workplace or school. Betrayal trauma can look like physical, emotional, sexual, or verbal abuse, infidelity, revelations of financial problems or significant debt, ulterior motives or other secretive behavior, psychical abuse, sexual harassment, manipulation, neglect, dishonesty, just to name a few when it comes to a narcissist. Symptoms may include physical illness, anxiety or panic disorder, depression, dissociative symptoms, post-traumatic stress disorder symptoms, substance use and overdose, and rumination. What betrayal trauma does to the body. The betrayed can experience flashbacks, nightmares, disrupted sleep, insomnia, depression, brain fog, distraction, hypervigilance, angry outbursts, social withdrawal, fearfulness. Often coupled with these symptoms is the debilitating emotion of shame. And I want you to keep that in mind as I talk about forgiveness. Since most of you listening here have survived a narcissist, even many narcissists at the same time, you've learned to cope somehow, some way, within the relationship and then later with the aftermath. And that is no small feat. You honestly deserve a medal. But then you have to get to the next process, which is grief, and you've hopefully made it through the process, which, by the way, will often encompass grieving each and every betrayal, and often the loss of everything and everyone that was dear to you. Item by item grieving could take many years, if not decades. Second, forgiveness, according to Psychology Today, means forgoing the impulse to punish, resent, and carry a grudge. Now, hold on here because I don't want to lose you. Because if you've ever had the most unfortunate experience of knowing a narcissist, those things will be first and foremost in your mind for quite some time. And I want to emphasize, this is a normal reaction to an insane person and situation that person has put you in. So please don't beat yourself up about that. And here comes the best part I really want you to hear. If done in recognition of the self-harm inflicted by the impulse to punish, resent, and bear grudges, forgiveness becomes an issue of personal health and well-being more than morality. However, one function of forgiveness is religious or spiritual, and I think most people get caught up in this one, hit a wall, so to speak, and end up feeling angrier. Angry at God for their situation and angry at themselves for falling for someone who was a total con. And why should the narcissist get away with such evil? Where's the justice, right? Surely it's not fair. But thankfully now we know there's another way. Regarding the religious aspect, I think a lot of people think about forgiveness this way. That is, one forgives and forgives and forgives, prays a lot about it, and try to forget over and over until they might reach some sort of emotional detachment. Most people don't know that that's the name of what they're working for. So what is emotional detachment? Detachment from an emotional bond occurs at the point when you become able to think about your betrayer narcissist without significant positive or negative emotion. In other words, you're getting over it. That kind of forgiveness is described as bringing peace. But some would say that that detachment through forgiveness is rare. But I don't think so. Now that more people are becoming aware that there is a faster, more efficient way to get there. Another problem with the religious spiritual aspect of forgiveness is some people think when they've forgiven the narcissist, they can somehow forget what happened and keep the toxic person in their life. And we all know by now that the narcissist will, of course, be on their best behavior if they think they're in trouble. They will appear sincere and they will try to get back into your life, but not because you've forgiven them and they're humble and thankful, but because they want to punish you for ever thinking that they did anything wrong in the first place. So here's what I propose. What if one just takes forgiveness in any religious or esoteric sense out of the equation and just work on emotional detachment using low or no contact as one of the prescriptions for peace of mind? For a time, while one is healing, one can separate the two to some extent. That doesn't mean one doesn't pray and trust God about their situation, but perhaps be able to think about these two things in a different way. More and more of us are learning emotional detachment as a valuable skill. That is, recognizing that hate and anger only hurts us and causes havoc on our bodies and minds. And seeking revenge on the narcissist doesn't feel good either. Well, in the moment it might, but in the long run, it's usually a disaster, and it's not who we are. Doing to the narcissist what they've done to us, although it may be well deserved, we have a memory and above all a conscience and run the risk of hurting ourselves in the long run. At the very least, we will feel horrible about sinking to their level. Remember, oftentimes, the narcissist wants us to seek revenge so they can play Darvo. They can point the finger and say, see, it was them all along. In fact, in my experience, this was part of my ex's plan, right from the beginning, so he could play the eternal victim. For myself to heal from narcissistic abuse via emotional detachment is the healing process that works for me. In my own forgive and forget model, I focus on forgiving myself, period. In doing that, I'm grieving loss by loss, as well as shedding myself of all the nasty projections of the narcissist, especially shame. That said, I think most victims hate themselves for a number of reasons. For falling for the con, for reacting to the tricks and traps, as well as the shame and humiliation of ever knowing such an evil POS as a narcissist. The goal is to work on emotional detachment with indifference as the brass ring. Wow. Once you reach indifference, you truly are narcissist-free and living peace of mind. You also get to keep your conscience free and clear, and your self-worth and self-esteem intact. For victims of narcissists, this is a win-win. It doesn't feel like it for a long time, but once you get to indifference, it will. But another thing I'd like to emphasize is you put the shame where it belongs, with the narcissist. You start to understand that all their toxic projections and reactions to them they elicited within you were never yours and always belonged to them. Whether they know it or not, they are forever playing a sick psychological mind game with you, so they never have to be accountable for their own bad behavior. But more than that, they never want to feel shame or guilt for that bad behavior. In other words, on some level, they know they're evil and shameful and want to keep doing it. Once you can make your way to indifference, you start to see that. And don't worry about the narcissist. Their karma, if you will, is being them. I can't think of a worse fate. Being trapped in a developmentally arrested mind that is incapable of processing high vibration emotion, only being able to focus on their hatred and envy of those who are whole, healthy, and happy. Indifference is kryptonite to narcissists. Forgive yourself and forget the narcissist.